Well, that was nice. Thank you so much, and good morning. It's good to have you all here. It's beginning to look more and more familiar as folks come back and are participating in worship here in person, but we also remember that we have a number of folks who are with us online, so we want to greet those folks as well and remind you that both of our services are carried online, live, and then one of the services is posted to our website and our Facebook page in the afternoon. So good to have you all present for worship. It seems like we've been doing this a lot lately, which is a good thing to do. We have a new baby and a new grandbaby, Cohen Kilby Newton, who was born last night at 10:45, 7 pounds, 3 ounces. Caitlin Kilby Newton and Jay Newton are the proud parents. And Tom and Tammy Kilby are the slightly proud grandparents. Tom told me last night that it was about all he could do to stop Tammy from actually running down to Georgia and being down there. So I think they're going this morning, and we wish them safe travels, and we're certainly excited about this, in addition to the other babies and grandbabies that have been born here recently. Thank you so much to the congregation and to volunteers for a couple of things. First of all, for bringing those supplies for our personal health kits that our youth could put together. 100 personal health kits put together last week after worship, and to all of you who helped with the vaccine clinic and those of you who got your vaccines, thank you so much for your help with that as well. And we have another one coming up in the second one, right, is in June the 22nd. Okay, so we may need some volunteers, or certainly will need some volunteers for that as well. I really haven't said too much about my upcoming six-week Bible study, which I've wanted to do for a long time, and this gives me an opportunity to do it. I feel like with people away, that maybe this is a good opportunity to come together, but I'm calling it Movies That Matter. We're going to be watching a whole movie, the whole thing, each week on Wednesday nights, beginning at 6:30. This will be starting on June the 9th, I think, is the day. And we'll do it for 6 weeks during the middle of the summer. These are movies that I hope will be thoughtful, thought-provoking, insightful, meaningful for you. And then the discussion that follows. So I'm still in the midst of choosing the six films that we'll see, but I think they'll all be really good, really interesting, and I hope that you will consider joining us on these Wednesday nights. It'll be something different for the summer. So, we're glad that you're here. Is there anything else going on for the good of the church, for the good of the cause? We're grateful to have Kay with us this morning. Kay, thank you for sharing your gifts and talents with us. And we go back to the confession this Sunday. So let us stand together. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and sinking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. You may kneel or be seated or stand for this confession. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Let us stand together. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for His sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by His authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty Creator and ever-living God, we worship your glory, eternal three in one, and we praise your power, majestic one in three. Keep us steadfast in this faith. Defend us in all adversity, and bring us at last into your presence, where you live in endless joy and love. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us remain standing. Our song of praise is Change My Heart, O God.
Good morning, friends. How's everybody doing this morning? Who do you think we're going to talk about this morning? Jesus. Girl, we're going to talk about Jesus this morning. First, as a youth pastor and Pastor John, who's worked with young people for 35 years, thank you for the Robinsons for visiting this morning. And I'm going to just tell you, Blake was like one of my little kids. And you can see now that Blake is very tall. Lisa, you're not supposed to let him. I mean, I feel like, y'all must have fed him. Okay. But it's great to have y'all this morning. So welcome. So as we talk about Jesus this morning, today is Holy Trinity Sunday. So, when you get to explain theology to five-year-olds, then everybody else gets it too. So this morning, Pastor John, who is going to read to us out of the Bible, you're right, he is going to tell us a little bit about God. God as the Father, Jesus as the Son, and last week we learned about the Holy Spirit. That's right. And so today, in the text today, which I love, in the first reading from Isaiah, God calls us. God calls out. He says, which is one of my favorite verses. Here I am, send me. So then, I feel like in the second reading, it talks a lot about the Holy Spirit. And in the gospel reading, which Pastor John's going to read out of the book of John this morning, and in the third chapter of John is our favorite and easiest Bible verse. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that we should not perish but have everlasting life. We know that when we come to this baptismal font, and Charlie reminded me of it this morning, that every day with God and with Jesus, when we are reminded of the waters of baptism, we are made new every day. Like every day is a brand new day. And then to also remember that when we baptize, we also give a candle with the flame, which represents the Holy Spirit to lead and to guide us. And because Jesus gave of his only Son, then Jesus goes with us because Jesus is in our hearts. So Pastor John this morning is going to talk to you about the different names of Jesus. And today, on this Holy Trinity Sunday, we can remember that God goes with us because Jesus is in our hearts, and the Holy Spirit leads and guides us. So that's what we can remember this week, that the Holy Spirit is burning inside of us. And because we are Jesus's friends, we are also his disciples. Thank you. Look, I feel like I'm training her up well. I can't wait. So that's what we can remember today, that the Holy Spirit goes with us and it leads us and guides us. And Pastor John's going to talk about all the different names that we have for God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. So with that, the Lord be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Dear good and gracious Heavenly Father, we give you thanks this day for all that you give us, but especially your Son, Jesus. Lord, we know that you give us Jesus so that we might have eternal life in you. That we, if we believe, we are made clean and new each day. Lord, let us go out and let us preach the gospel, and let us be here for our congregation and our community. In your name, in Jesus' name we pray. Can I get it? Amen. Amen. All right. Sorry about that.
The first reading today is from the sixth chapter of Isaiah. The reading narrates Isaiah's vision of the Lord surrounded by angels. They sing, "Holy, holy, holy," a song the church sings at the beginning of the Great Thanksgiving. This liturgical text invites the church and all creation to sing in praise of God's glory. That glory is God's mercy towards sinners. Now for the reading from Isaiah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots and the thresholds shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost. I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am, Lord, send me." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. The second reading is taken from the 8th chapter of Romans. In describing the new life of faith, Paul refers to all three persons of the Trinity. The Spirit leads us to recognize that we are children of God, the Father, and joint heirs with Christ the Son. Now the reading from Romans. Brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, "Abba, Father," it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 3rd chapter, and we say together, "Glory to you, O Lord." Jesus' miracles prompt Nicodemus to visit him in secrecy. Jesus tells him about being born of the Spirit and about the Son who has been sent by God to save. Now the reading from John's Gospel. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" And Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." This is the gospel of the Lord, and we say together, "Praise to you, O Christ." You may be seated. Several years back, I was in my office in Albemarle, just working hard, which of course I always do. when the phone rang and a young woman's voice greeted me on the other end. "Pastor Futterer," she said, "this is Lauren from China Grove. I was wondering if you remember me." Lauren from China Grove. It took me a minute. I began to think, and a picture came into my mind, a little girl, blonde, probably around 8 or 9 years old, always dressed up really pretty. Ann had been her Sunday school teacher. It had been a long time. It had been 20 years, in fact. But yes, I did remember Lauren from China Grove. "Pastor Futterer," she said, "I hope you can do me a really big favor. I'm getting married next summer, and I would like you to do my service." Now, every profession has its secrets. You know, I don't know what it's like to be a teacher. I don't know what it's like to be a small business owner. I don't know what it's like to be an executive. But I know that whatever vocation you are in or you were in, there are little nuances to that vocation that the only way you can know about them is if you actually do them, if you're a part of that vocation. So the inside information about being a pastor is that weddings are really hard. Of all the things that we do in our ministerial life, weddings are a lot of work, and they are a lot of pressure. I will never forget the helpful advice that Palmer Klemmer gave me the week before I was to do my first wedding here. Palmer called me up and he said, "Not to put any pressure on you, but don't mess this up." And then in his own inimitable way, he said, "You know, people forget a lot of things, but they don't forget their wedding. Make sure you do this right." So, of course, I was cool as a cucumber as I went into my first wedding. But, you know, think about weddings. There's a lot at stake. Emotions are very high. People have spent a lot of money. They are usually on one of the hottest days of the year. There's a rehearsal, and you deal with young groomsmen who are set on having a good time. Brides, and bless their hearts, brides' mothers are nervous. There's just a lot about a wedding, and so I began to make excuses. "Well, Lauren, you know, I'm looking at my calendar for next summer, and my goodness, it is already so full. I've got a mission trip, and I've got camp formation, and you know, I'm going to try and take a vacation myself, so I really just don't know." And then she nailed me. "Pastor Futterer," she said, "I have never forgotten you. Even after all these years, you made such a difference in my life." What a terrible thing to say to a pastor. In an instant, I could feel my steely resolve melting away and my tiny heart growing, much like the Grinch, you know, three times as large. But of course, I remained humble, as a pastor should. "Lauren, of course I'll do your wedding. I'm very flattered that I made such a difference in your life. You know, I'm guessing it was probably my children's sermons. You were the right age for those to have had an impact." And I could hear her thinking on the phone, and she said, "No, I don't really remember your children's sermons." "Oh, well," I said, "I remember that I taught your vacation Bible school class 1 year. I think VBS that year was called Great Bible Reef, and we were, you know, we all looked at stories about water in the Bible. We brought in a wading pool, and we brought in some goldfish. You probably remember that." "Well, I do remember that, but I thought that was your wife and Miss Glass that taught Bible school, but I guess you were there." Could it have been First Communion classes, I suggested. Remember, we actually went into the kitchen and we made bread together and we used it the next Sunday for your class's First Communion. That was the first time at Kimball we had ever used real bread for communion. Oh, and remember, we also burned palm branches and made ashes for Ash Wednesday. That was the first time we ever used ashes at Kimball. Maybe you remember that. Could have been. I'm not sure I connect you with any of those things, though. I tried some other things. I took the kids bowling. I helped with 3 Christmas pageants. I brought them ice cream every opportunity that I had. No. One of the things about Lauren is she was always brutally honest, even as a child. And finally I said, Lauren, I don't believe that I have made any impression on you at all. What could you possibly remember about me? And she said, I remember that you always knew my name. And I've never forgotten that. Only that. But how important that was. Even as a third grader, Lauren was smart enough to know that all the talk about love, all the talk about community, all the talk about being a part of the body of Christ doesn't mean much if you don't even know my name. I'm so grateful that I ended up doing that wedding back in the summer of 2008. Lauren Peeler Hood was here last Sunday at our early service to watch her brother join our congregation. And now I am also grateful that I have a young deacon who helps me with names, which I can assure you come much harder these days. Names say a lot about who we are and where we've come from. My name, John, that was my mother's favorite name for a boy. Windus is my middle name. It was my grandmother's maiden name and is a testament to the fact that amidst all the Lutherans and Catholics on my father's side, there was at least one Episcopalian who had snuck in somewhere. And Futterer, which is German working class, from a long line of hard-working people. Names say a great deal about us. Today is Holy Trinity Sunday, as Liz told our children in the children's sermon this morning. We think about 3 names for God, right? Father, the Creator. Son, Jesus, the Redeemer. And Spirit, the Comforter, the Helper. The word she used last week, which is such a great word, the Advocate, the one who is beside us to help us along the way. Remember that Jesus was called Jesus because that's what the angel told Joseph to name him. The name Jesus means savior from sins, which is precisely what Jesus does. Jesus saves us from our sins. Today I want us to think about some other names for Jesus. Jesus is also called the Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One, the Deliverer. Maybe you remember that several weeks back we sang that wonderful song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Jesus is our friend, but He is also the Word made flesh. We speak words to people. Jesus is God's Word to us, a word about life and about hope and about peace. We say that Jesus is light. In this cold and dark world, Jesus shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. It is no accident that the coming of Jesus at Christmas is at the very darkest time of the year, when the days are short and the nights are long, and it's cold. Jesus is the light of the world. Jesus is bread, even if it's prepackaged bread. Jesus is basic, the staff of life. We feed on Jesus and we find our deepest hungers satisfied. Jesus is the vine, deeply rooted, drawing life directly from God the Father and connecting us to each other through the Holy Spirit. I did a wedding yesterday. Liz was here doing the technical work for it. The young woman who plans to join our church said that she knew this was the church she wanted to attend when she saw the stained glass window behind us and the words, "Come unto me." Jesus is the good shepherd who not only protects the sheep, but goes out looking for the lost sheep. And when Jesus finds it, he lifts it up, places it on his shoulder, and carries it back home. We sometimes forget that Jesus is also our judge, the last judge we will ever face. And our values, our attitudes, our behavior are all subject to Jesus' judgment. And yet we are reminded in this place again and again that Jesus judges with grace and with truth and with love. We call Jesus King, the ruler of the world. He is in charge and he shall reign forever and ever. And yet this King Jesus is also the gentle, obedient, wounded, bleeding Lamb of God, who is on our level, who was slain for your sins and my sins, and who is a king, but a king who reigns from a cross. Word, light, bread, vine, judge, king, lamb. Jesus is all of these things and so much more. And as we heard in today's gospel, it is in baptism in his name that you and I are born again, that we are made new, that we are lifted up to a new life and a new future. Please don't forget this. God in Jesus Christ knows your name. And so the question for us this morning is, will we continue to risk knowing and proclaiming his name? Will we strive to discern his will for our lives? It is that name above every other name that wants to be called upon, wants to be served, wants to be loved. And so will we. Thanks be to God for this incredible privilege and this incredible opportunity. Amen. This is the final Sunday for a while that we will be using the Nicene Creed as our affirmation of faith. With the people of God in Christ now and in every time, let us stand as we confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us now come before the triune God in prayer. We invite you to kneel or be seated as able for the prayers. This session, the prayer petitions will conclude. Lord, in your mercy and our response is hear our prayer. We pray, O God, for your holy church around the world. Revitalize us and renew us, that we may be reborn once again through the waters of baptism and the blowing wind of your Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks for your power that is revealed to us in creation, for cedar and oak trees, for rushing waters, for the echoes of thunder, for the coming joys of summer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the nations and for all of our leaders, that led by your Spirit, they might work towards a world where all of your children enjoy peace. We pray especially for Israel and for Palestine, which are experiencing terrible war. And we ask that your Spirit of peace might be given to the people there and to people in conflict wherever they might be. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for healing for all those who suffer. Especially this day, we pray for victims and survivors of trauma or violence. Give respite and hope to those who are living with PTSD or with any other mental health concerns. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for this congregation, that the splendor of your majesty and the holiness of your mystery may be glorified through our worship and through our deepening relationships with one another. We rejoice with the Kilby family at the birth of Cohen. We ask that you would be, O Lord, with all who will have surgery this coming week. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks, O God, for all those who have died in the faith. And especially on this Memorial Day weekend, we give you thanks for those who gave their lives for our freedoms and our liberties. May we never take their sacrifice for granted or take our liberties and freedoms for granted. Grant, O God, that they may not have died in vain. May we draw new vigor and wisdom from past tragedy. Increase our instincts for peace, and give us the vision to see that the world is now far too dangerous for anything but the truth, and far too small for anything but love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your abiding grace. Amen. Let us stand together. Following his resurrection, the Lord Jesus breathed peace upon his disciples. We share in this peace of Christ in the church today, and so we say, the peace of the Lord be with you. And also with you. Let us share God's peace with one another. For those who are watching on Facebook Live, we invite you to, if you wish to participate in this sacrament, to have your elements ready. For those here in the congregation, it's that time for us to get our elements ready for communion. You know, it's been so long since we did communion, you know, like we normally do. We have a hard time remembering whether or not we're supposed to stand during these words of institution, right? I can't remember. Isn't that terrible? Let's stand. I think that's what we're supposed to do. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it for them to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered as one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray together as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated and receive the elements as these words are said. This is the body of Christ, which is given for you. And this is the blood of Christ, which is shed for you.
To
Let us stand together. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in His grace. Amen. I'd like to remind all of our worshipers today that there are baskets strategically placed throughout the sanctuary for your communion ware this morning as you leave. And please remember that ushers will be dismissing us. You can greet us outside under the bell tower after the service. And so now receive this benediction, the blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen. Our sending song is Shout to the Lord.